Good morning, Downtown Hope. My name is Jen, and it is a joy to worship together this morning. At DH, we are a body of believers seeking gospel transformation in our city and in the world. If you're newer here, it is great to have you. Be sure to go to our website, downtownhope.org, to get connected. And as we move towards having in-person gatherings on February 7th, we'd love to have you there. And if you're interested in serving with us, whether on the hospitality team or worship or tech, we'd love to have you. You can email me at jen.healy@downtownhope.org, and I can share more about those opportunities with you. Now, as we prepare hearts for worship, would you please join me and the body of believers around the world reading scripture from the Common Lectionary? You can read aloud with me. Psalm 114. When Israel went out from Egypt, the house of Jacob from a people of strange language, Judah became his sanctuary, Israel his dominion. The sea looked and fled, Jordan turned back. The mountains skipped like rams, the hills like lambs. What ails you, O sea, that you flee? O Jordan, that you turn back? O mountains, that you skip like rams, O hills, like lambs. Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob, who turns the rock into a pool of water, the flint into a spring of water.
Sing praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Good morning, church. I invite you to praise and worship with me wherever you're at. Singing praises. We sing love songs of Jesus this morning. Father God, we ask you to fill this place, fill our hearts after this long week. So much going on in the world, Father. We just want your love just for a moment to feel you in our hearts. You're such a good, good Father. I've heard a thousand.
No, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you are pleased and that I'm never alone. Sing, you're a good. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen. No, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know We're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To love so undeniable, love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Good morning, Downtown Hope. My name is Joey, and I have the gift of serving our church as lead pastor. Each week as we gather, we join with brothers and sisters in Christ around the world for a time of confession. With everything that's gone on in our nation over the last several days, what I'd like to do is focus our time now to pray together over our nation. There's a wonderful organization called the Chalmers Center, which is based out of Covenant College. They're part of the PCA, the Presbyterian Church of America, and they put out a prayer this week that we read, and we just felt it was appropriate and it would be powerful for us to pray this prayer together as a church. After each section, there's a little part on the end that just says, Lord, hear our prayer. And if you're sitting in your homes and you want to join in with us and say that together collectively, that would be powerful. This is part of how we pray, how the church prays globally. So let's pray together. O God Almighty, heaven is your throne and the earth is your footstool. You are the one in whose hand the hearts of kings of this earth are streams of water that you direct where you will. You are the one who has entered into our pain through Christ Jesus our Lord, and one who reigns on high. Lord, hear our prayer. Father, as we witness the heartache of political division that spills into rage and violence, we cry out in pain and sorrow, Jesus. We cry out for your rule and your reign as king to be manifest, even as we see the works of sinful humans and the devil on display. Holy Spirit, we cry out for your eyes, for the eyes of our hearts as people, to be open to see our sin and to see our hope in you and nowhere else. We see that your will is not done on earth as it is in heaven, that the poor are mocked, and that your name is carried in vain. So we cry out to you as you have taught us to pray. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we turn to you in this time as we should in every time, because you hold the words of life and truth. You are the one in whom all things hold together. You have promised to reconcile all things by the blood of your cross, to make all things new, to wipe away our tears, and to make your dwelling place again with us. As you have been faithful to all generations, we ask you to fulfill your promises in your church today. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we beg you to grant your hope and peace to the people of the United States of America. We long not for shallow peace of quiet streets, but for the peace that comes from you, your shalom that makes all things new under your righteous reign. We long to see your body, the church, and every member thereof in our land renewed with your spirit of peace. We long to see churches teach your heart for the poor and commit themselves to lift up the weak rather than to prop up the mighty. We cry out for your people to be a witness to your kingdom, to a city whose foundation and builder is you, that is vaster and richer than any vision offered by earthly politics. We lament the spirit of division that prevents those who call themselves your children from listening in, learning from, and making sacrifices for others. We cry out as brothers and sisters who are bewitched by falsehoods and conspiracies, even as we recognize our complicity in their loneliness and despair. Lord, hear our prayer. If, O Lord, you are not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, then we beg that you would allow repentance to flow forth from this land and from those who have incited and perpetrated violence, from those who have stood silent as evil was plotted, and from those who have been consumed with our own comfort rather than the deep needs of our neighbors. We do not wish evil on any of these, but Lord, we ask that you would cast down Satan and all his works and remove the blindness of demonic forces from our land. We name the devil as the true enemy of peace and pray that you would enable us to love our brothers and sisters even as we long for repentance and justice. If you would mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? Let us therefore watch with humility against our own pride and hatred. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift our petition to you, knowing that you hear our prayer. Lord, we carry our pain to you, knowing that you are sufficient to hold it and able to comfort. Lord, we carry our grievances to you, knowing that you are holy and just and able to do more than we ask or imagine. Lord, hear our prayer. I want to encourage us as a church. We have a prayer team that's available to pray with you. We have a wonderful team of support and counselors. Michelle Hammer leads that, who would love to talk with you if you want to process anything. Our elder team is available. We have many leaders who are available. We are with you. We want to encourage you, and we want to encourage our body to pray this week as the inauguration comes up, that God's peace and his shalom would rest upon our land, and that we would be utensils, vehicles, instruments of God's peace in the world as his church. Let's continue to pray this week, and let's continue now to sing to our King, the one that we put our hope in. Let's sing together. You are perfect.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're a good, good Father. To you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Good morning, Downtown Hope. My name's Colin. I am the student director here. And as you hear every Sunday, Downtown Hope is a community of believers that are being transformed by the gospel of Jesus. It's an ongoing process in our lives as we seek him, as we get into his word and into community. And if you've experienced gospel transformation in your life through your relationship with Jesus, you will understand that a lot of it happens and manifests in the idea and the framework of community. And when I say community, I don't mean just hanging out once a week for an hour or two, but I mean actually committing to know to know other people and be fully known by them. I mean, carrying each other and also allowing other people to carry you in different seasons. In Acts chapter 2, it tells us that a community of believers in the book of Acts is devoted to, they devoted themselves to the teaching, fellowship, into the breaking of bread, into prayer. And I want to highlight that word fellowship today during our vision portion, because at Downtown Hope, we have a student ministry program that is desiring to see gospel transformation happen in the context of community in middle school and high school students. There's in this idea of fellowship, there's relationship, there's companionship, there's partnership, there's stewardship. It's a deep understanding of being known and knowing others. And that's why we've committed ourselves to meeting Sunday afternoons at 3 o'clock behind the space to have fires on a weekly basis to start to develop a sense of community where students are not just known, but they know others, that they are not just spectators, but they are participants in the body of Christ. And so we just wanted to make sure as we communicate this year that our desire is to see our students being transformed by the gospel of Jesus so that they in turn can see that happen in the lives of their friends and their peers all across the school districts that we serve. Today, I just want to take a moment and pray as Joey gets ready to bring us back into our series called Fulfilled, A Journey Through the Book of Luke. So would you just join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we give you all the honor and glory and praise, knowing, God, that every single breath and every single word that we speak, Lord, is a gift given by you. Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord, that we would wake up with thankful and grateful hearts because of what you have done, Lord, for your creation and the plan that you had for redeeming your people and to transform us by sending your Son, that we could have Jesus in our lives, Lord, that we can, in faith, proclaim the good news that sets the captives free. Heavenly Father, I pray this season, in the midst of isolation, that, Lord, you'd give us a new sense of community in the midst of not just our student community groups, but all the community groups meeting throughout the Annapolis area, Lord. I pray, God, that you would remind us that you designed us to be in community, that, God, you reveal yourself in us individually, but also in the people around us. I pray, God, that you would strengthen the communities all throughout this area in this year to come. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Well, what a gift to gather together. Thank you, Migs, for offering your incredible gift of song and music and worship to our King. Just want to encourage us, and in this next season, we're so excited about where we're headed as a church. As Jen mentioned, as David's mentioned, as we've been talking about on our website and through communication, we're going to begin in-person gatherings on February 7th, and we're so excited to have people in the space with us. But one of the really exciting things is we're also going to be live streaming at that time. So I know that many of us have been watching the gatherings at different times, and this next season we want to encourage you. Let's join in as one body together, whether you're watching at home, whether you're in person in the space, where we would just love for you to join us at 10 a.m. And actually, we're going to begin live streaming on January 24th, which we're really excited about. The team has just been working so hard, and we're so thankful to the Lord for them. The last thing I just want to keep on our radar as a church is on January 31st, we're going to have a virtual church family meeting. We do an update meeting at the beginning of every year, looking back to 2020, seeing how the Lord worked in beautiful ways. We want to invite anybody and everybody who considers Downtown Hope their church home to join us. It's going to be online through a Zoom call. You can sign up, and please sign up. We need you to sign up so you can get the Zoom link on our website. And then it's just going to be a great time together as a whole church family. There'll be some time for Q&A at the end. It'll be looking back to 2020 and looking forward to 2021. As Colin mentioned, we're continuing our series this morning called Fulfilled through Luke's Gospel. And we want to encourage you to track along with us through your discipleship bands and your community groups. You can use our resource called The Daily and sign up for that. We just want to be in this process and on this journey of being formed, transformed by God's grace through His Word and through the power of His Spirit. So let me read to us Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 14, and then we'll dive in together. Luke chapter 4, starting verse 1. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit to the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. But when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will be all yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and serve only him shall you serve." And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went throughout all the surrounding country, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And this is God's word. Let's pray. Father, as we open your word this morning, as we are praying over our nation, as we are asking for your kingdom to come in greater measures to our lives and our city, to see the flourishing of our neighbors, to see the gospel impact lives, we're asking that you would begin with us, Lord. We are a completely imperfect people, Lord, in process here. Lord, struggling, many of us, all of us, to some degree, with different temptations. And we're asking that the truth of this word would encourage us and convict us this morning, Lord, that your Spirit would speak through me, that the things that are from you would be remembered and the things that are not from you, Lord, would be forgotten, and that we would be shaped. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come speak through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, every Christmas in our home, we get a delivery. We get a delivery from our old high school friend. Her name's Jen Bailey. And every year she drops off this wonderful kind of chocolate bark. But in the midst of the chocolate bark is really the gold, the thing that I love the most. And it is these homemade peanut butter cups. I mean, like, watch out, Reese's. These peanut butter cups could be sold at any store because they are the sweetest and most tender and most delicious thing ever. I mean, I love peanut butter, and I love peanut butter and chocolate, and having those things together. And I know they're coming around Christmas, and they're delivered in this nice little bag. And when they show up every year, there's always a question, who gets the peanut butter cups? And it's kind of known in my family, Dad gets the peanut butter cups. But, you know, I'm trying to be a good father, a good husband, share the peanut butter cups. But every single year, they're sitting there in the pantry, and I'm thinking to myself all day long, those peanut butter cups are right there, and I just want to eat one every minute. There's only like 5 of them, by the way. Maybe next year, Jen, you could send like 10 or 20 of them. And I'm constantly tempted. I mean, I am just tempted. I just want to eat. I would love to eat. I would stuff them all in my mouth because they're that amazing. And every year, I'm just having to exercise self-control in this moment of temptation. Will Dad eat all the peanut butter cups? Will Joey, my husband, eat all the peanut butter cups? Or will he save some for the family? And it always ends up at the end that all the peanut butter cups are gone. The rest of the chocolate bark's in there. We're not as into that. Sorry, Jen. We really love the peanut butter cups, not the other stuff. But it is a constant temptation for me every Christmas. And if you're human like me, you know that we all constantly experience an onslaught of temptation in our lives. Like every day, moment by moment, there's temptation that we face. Some time ago, I knew a guy He was publicly involved in some things that he shouldn't have been, in my opinion. I was frustrated that he had made a public appearance in some of these things, things that were unhelpful, activities that were harmful to others. And certainly the name of Jesus is one of those things that you have friends and neighbors who don't know Christ or who have been disconnected or hurt by the church. And they're like, I don't want anything to do with that guy because of what he's saying and how he's acting. And I have to be honest, I was frustrated. Like, I was mad that he was involved in these things. I was angry. And part of it, no doubt, was righteous anger. But part of it, along with it, came this deep-seated temptation in my life, a real temptation, not peanut butter cup temptation, but actual temptation. I was tempted to cut him off. I mean, I had some real anger in my heart. I know none of you can relate to that. I had this temptation, right? Why don't you just isolate him? Why don't you just expose him? Why don't you just put him out there? To a certain extent, why don't you just cut him off relationally? And it was a real temptation. I'm not excited or proud to share that or confess that, but it was a real thing going on in my heart because this guy and what he was involved in was frustrating me to the core. What was going on inside of me in that moment? What was happening in me? We all face temptations in different ways. In the first couple chapters of Luke, we've learned that the Messiah has arrived. That's what Luke is teaching us. And then in chapter 3, the scene jumps some 20 years, and we find John the Baptizer is preparing the way, and Jesus is baptized. And then in chapter 4, we find Luke is constantly showing us how Jesus fulfills his Messiahship, constantly is showing us who he is as the Messiah. And we find in this passage the most interesting way that Jesus is shown as the Messiah. Because if we were writing this story, we might think that the way to prove that Jesus is the Messiah is to show him in power and strength. And if the devil shows up in the scene, he's conquering him and stomping him out. But instead, what we find in this account is almost the opposite. We find Jesus in the wilderness, in isolation himself, in hunger. The Messiah is not found on a throne. Jesus isn't in a castle. He's not in a temple. He's not in a synagogue first. He's found as he begins his ministry in the fullness of his humanity, fully divine Jesus is, but here we find just a full picture of his humanity coming through the same experience that we undergo every single day of our lives, temptation. Temptation. And the word here in Greek in verse 2, where it says he was for 40 days being tempted, is a word for temptation or test. I love some of the way that the definition rolls out here, to try whether a thing can be done. Okay, it's not just a temptation, but it's also a test. It's the same word, to attempt, to try, to make trial of, to test, for the purpose of ascertaining its quantity, or what he thinks, or how he will behave himself. So it's a test, it's a temptation. It's the same word used in all the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and here in Luke. It's what Cain is struggling with in Genesis chapter 4, when his sacrifice was not accepted by the Lord. We find sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. It's what James chapter 1 says, let no one say when he is tempted, I'm being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire, and then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it fully is grown, brings forth or gives birth to death. It's what Dallas Willard says in his book, Renovation of the Heart, choice is where sin dwells. And there's a lot of ways to define temptation, but one of the ways is to say temptation is that invitation to snatch for ourselves what has not been offered to us by God. Temptation is that invitation to grab or snatch or secure for ourselves that which has not been offered to us by God. And I'm wondering, what is it for you this morning? Where is that temptation lurking? Where are you being tempted? Are you tempted to slander a person, that person in your life? Are you tempted to engage in an inappropriate conversation with that person who's not your spouse? Are you tempted to doubt your employer or the authorities in your life, their motives? Are you tempted to cheat on your exams or in school? Are you tempted to lie about something that you did wrong, a sin in your life? Are you tempted to steal that thing, whatever that thing is, music or art or intellectual property? Or maybe you're just tempted to fear this morning. It's a big thing right now in our culture. And in this passage, what we have is this intimate account of Jesus experiencing temptation. And we learn about the nature of temptation and how we, by God's grace and the Holy Spirit's power, can resist the temptation in our lives. There's three movements in this passage. There's a timing to temptation that we find here. There's an attack of temptation. What is the attack of temptation? And then thirdly, what is the resistance of temptation? So the timing of temptation, the attack of temptation, and the resistance of temptation. So first, the timing of temptation. Now, verse 1 and verse 14, we find that the Holy Spirit is bookending this passage. It's as if to say God, the Holy Spirit, is with us even in our darkest moments of temptation. That off the start here should be an encouragement for us. When we go through something, when we are tempted, okay, it's not, as James says, God tempting us, but it is to say that the Lord is with us to strengthen us even in our darkest moments of temptation. When we think there's no way out, the Lord is there to open up a door for us. We don't have to submit to it. Secondly, we find in the timing of temptation, the reality that it is the devil who tempts us. That's second part of verse 2 there. Jesus is being tempted specifically by the devil. Now, St. Augustine's definition of sin for us is along the lines of sin being something that's distortive or corruptive, something that is overemphasized or underemphasized, things in our lives that are disordered. It's a great definition of sin. It's a part of definition of sin. It's a helpful definition of sin. But there is also an aspect that the scripture speaks to, that there is a real evil, sinister force who is attempting to deceive us and harm us. That's the devil. That's the enemy of our souls. And there is real demonic presence in our world and in our lives, constantly trying to distract and discourage and throw us off. Jesus himself describes the enemy in John 10:10. He says, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. That's a real thing. So do not think for a moment that the things that are happening, the divisions in our world, are just simply because, well, we're just corruptive and we're just distorted and we just disorder our loves. Absolutely, that's part of it. Those are effects of it. But there is a real enemy behind it all who is stirring these things up. Let us not be naive, my brothers and sisters. This is Peter in 1 Peter 5:8. He's a guy in the Bible who knew firsthand about the enemy's temptations. He writes, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around you like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Resist him firm in your faith." And this leads us to understanding what the timing of temptation is for the enemy of our souls. And the answer to that question we find in this next verse here, verse 3. It's vulnerability. We are most susceptible to temptation. We're vulnerable to temptation in our vulnerability. Verse 3, Jesus ate nothing for those days. Now, 40 days without food and 40 days, and this isn't talked about much, but 40 days without people around him, human beings. It's part of God's grace to us as people in our lives. And Jesus had neither of those. He was deprived of bread and food, and he was deprived of relationship for 40 days. And here he is in this moment. How would you describe him? Vulnerable. Vulnerable. Now, when we read 40 days in this passage, it should trigger us to think about the Old Testament. Scripture interprets Scripture. We always want to understand what is the New Testament saying as it relates to the Old Testament. So 40 days, where else do we find the number 40 in the scripture? And this automatically throws us back to the nation of Israel as they're wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. We walk through that earlier this summer as we were walking through the book of Numbers. Into the Wild, we call the series. And you can go back and listen to those online, a great series. And we track with the nation of Israel wandering through the desert. So just as Israel came through the waters out of Egypt, so Christ comes through the water in baptism before this passage. As Israel was 40 years in the wilderness, so Jesus was 40 days in the wilderness. By the way, it was the same wilderness that Jesus was in as the nation of Israel was in Deuteronomy chapter 8. Moses even spends 40 days on Mount Sinai, the representative of Israel, spending 40 days right before a significant point in his ministry, even as Jesus, that's Exodus 24, even as Jesus here is spending 40 days in the wilderness in preparation right before he enters into his a significant time at the beginning of his ministry. And Israel is tempted just as Christ is tempted. They're tempted to despair as they cross the Red Sea. They're tempted with murmuring at Marah. They're tempted with hunger in the wilderness of sin. They're tempted with the golden calf at Sinai. They're tempted with the strange fire, the sons of the high priest. They're tempted with lust after what they had in Egypt. They're tempted with water. They're thirsting. They're tempted at Horeb with their disobedience. They're tempted with unbelief. And so we find this pattern of having this parallelism of what Israel was going through. Now we see Jesus going through. Even Moses fasted and prayed for 40 days in Exodus 24. And it's in these vulnerabilities, in this moment of our bodies lacking, that the greatest temptation comes upon us. The timing of temptation in our lives is always in our vulnerability. And I'm wondering this morning, what are your vulnerabilities? Are you aware of those? Are you physically tired? Are you emotionally tired? Are you spiritually tired? Is there something that big that's coming up in your life? Have you been isolated from people for some time? Maybe you've been in quarantine. Maybe it's been hard to get around people. These are the moments where the tempter comes to us, the enemy of our souls, and tries to seduce us away. And there's a specific kind of attack. This brings us to our second movement here. There's a specific kind of attack that the enemy of our soul makes, comes at us in our vulnerability. And we find this in verses 3 through 12. There's an attack within the temptation. What does the enemy attack when he's tempting us? Verse 3. Here's what the enemy says. Here's his opening line to Jesus. If you are the Son of God. That's how he begins his temptations. Now what is going on here? We're going to go through these temptations here. He's going to talk through them. But let me just make a really important observation here that sort of umbrellas this entire observation. The attack that the enemy makes in our lives through temptation almost always goes right after our most significant relationships. If you are the Son of God. Do you hear the question in it? The very nature of the statement begs a question. Jesus, is that really who you are? Because you've been here for 40 days, you haven't eaten anything, you haven't been around anybody. Are you really the Son of God? Is your relationship as a son to your Father secure? And this is where Satan wants to destroy us. This is his approach. This is his pattern. This is his design. If he can destroy the root of our relationships, everything else falls apart. If he can get at the most intimate places of our lives in our relationships, do not underestimate how the enemy wants to try to destroy marriages, destroy friendships, destroy churches. He goes after our spouses. He goes after our relationship with our parents. He goes after our relationships with our friends. He goes after our relationships with our children. He goes after our relationships with our relatives. He goes after our relationships with one another in the body of Christ. And I'll tell you right now, the enemy is having a heyday in our nation and in our world, dividing the body of Christ. And that's part of this message, to say we don't have to submit ourselves to that. This is the echo of Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, where the enemy in a different context is tempting our first mother, Eve. He says, did God actually say you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? Because ultimately, it's not just the intimate relationships we have human relationships that the enemy comes after. But behind that, underneath all of that, is actually a deeper wicked and evil question. And that question has to do with, do you as a person, as a human being, as a Christian, can you really trust your Heavenly Father? See, that's the question in the garden. Did God really say this to you? Can you really trust your Father in heaven? Can you really trust the God who created you? And this was the enemy's approach to tempting Jesus. It's kind of one big temptation. Are you secure in your Father's love? Are you stable in your Father's love? Let's look at these one by one. Verse 3. Here is the idea. He's attacking us at our core relationship with our Father in heaven. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread. Now, what is behind this question? It's a very simple question. It's a basic question. Will God really provide for you? It's a question of provision. It's a temptation for sustenance. It's a temptation for bread. There's a fear. And by the way, all these temptations are rooted and they play upon fear. There's a fear of not having enough. There's a fear of not having provision. And here the enemy goes right after Jesus when he is hungry. It says, will he really provide bread for you? I don't know if you can actually know that. And this is Israel in the desert, desperately wanting bread. Then they got bread, but it wasn't enough. Constantly, the enemy's goal is to erode our trust, our deep abiding in our Heavenly Father. And here it is right here. Will he really provide for you? Is he a God who provides? Second temptation, verses 5-7. And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And he said to him, to you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. Now, it's important to mention that in some sense, Satan has, you know, is the ruler of this world. That's John 12:31. Jesus says that, 1 John 5:19. But his claim here is not accepted as fully true. He doesn't have authority under God's ultimate and Christ's ultimate authority, because all authority belongs to Christ. All authority belongs to God. That's Romans 13. That's Psalm 24. And so there's a subtle erosion, again, of doubt, of questioning of who God is in relationship to Jesus. Who is the Father to the Son? Here's the question behind the question. Will he really love you? Will he really adore you? Will your Father really see you? Does he see you? I mean, here you are in this desert 40 days without food. Don't you need a little affirmation right now, Jesus? I can give that to you. I can give you power and I can give you glory. And think about the temptation. It stirs a fear of not being loved, a fear of not being valued, a fear of not being adored, a fear of not being paid attention to. One of the core lies that the enemy speaks over us or tempts us with. Who is God to you? Does he really know who you are? Does he really see you in the situation you're in? And then the third temptation, verse 9, and he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear up for you, lest you strike your foot against a stone. And so here, the pinnacle of the temple, probably located at the southeastern corner of the Temple Mount, it overlooked a steep drop down into a valley, probably some 300 feet below. And he quotes scripture, the enemy of our souls, twists, manipulates, distorts scripture. And it's a question of protection. Will God really protect you? Is he good? It's a temptation to test God's goodness. Throw yourself down. Will he protect you? Is he good? Can you trust that he will really catch you? Will he follow through? Test him. And we know this because Jesus responds, and we're going to look at this in a minute. Distrust of God's goodness. Is God good, or do you need to protect yourself? Is God good, and will he look after you and take care of you? Or do you need to secure yourself and make yourself safe? You see, the temptation behind every temptation is to believe a root lie about who God is. The issue with temptation is not primarily the act itself. If the act, the sinful act, you act or you don't act upon it, no doubt it will wreak havoc in your life, and it's tragic and it's sin and it's horrific. But underneath that temptation is a deeper question. Underneath that act is, or to not act, is a temptation to believe something. It's to believe a lie about the very nature of who your heavenly Father is. And that's where the enemy wants to attack us. Let me just walk through a couple of examples, and I want to talk about two that are really prevalent right now. Am I tempted to slander that person? I may be genuinely hurt by that person, but behind it, what's underneath? Maybe I don't really believe I'm as valued as I am by my Heavenly Father. And so because I have that deep-seated lie that I'm believing, I then am going to act out and sin against this brother or sister or this person in my life. Am I tempted to engage in an inappropriate conversation or relationship with somebody who's not my spouse? I may be struggling with connection with my spouse. Perhaps that's you this morning. But behind it, what's underneath of that is this deep thing. I don't actually believe that my Father in heaven can emotionally, relationally satisfy me, so I have to look elsewhere. Maybe you're tempted to doubt your employer or the authorities in your life, your parents' motives. You may be dealing with an imperfect leader. Chances are you absolutely are. Every leader is imperfect, myself included. But maybe underneath of it or behind it, it's the fact that you don't actually believe that your Father in heaven is trustworthy or good or looking out for you. And so it's not to say you shouldn't confront unhealthy leadership. That's a really healthy and important thing to do. It's to say that, check your heart, examine your heart, understand if there's a lie you're believing about who God is, his character and his nature and his relationship to you. Maybe you're tempted to cheat on your exams. Maybe you're genuinely struggling with the feeling of a need to be perfect or have a perfect resume, but behind it, underneath of it, what you're really struggling with is that you don't feel like you would be accepted by your Father in heaven if you lose or if you fail. Maybe you're tempted to lie about something you did wrong. You may be dealing with guilt or shame behind it. I get that. That makes sense. That's probably a healthy thing in terms of feeling healthy guilt around lying. But maybe underneath of it, there's a deep desire for affirmation. You feel like you won't be loved. You won't be accepted. You'll be rejected by your Father in heaven if you fail. And so you lie about it to cover yourself. Maybe you're tempted to steal something. You may be struggling with coveting. That may be a reality. But maybe behind it, you don't actually believe your Father in heaven will provide. But the thing I want to talk about just directly and have a real conversation together with as a church is about the fear, the temptation of fear that's running rampant in our culture right now. And let me just share a couple thoughts on this because I think it's probably the strongest example of temptation we're facing as a nation that many of us in our church may be facing today. When you start to remove God from the center of a culture, from the center of a nation, not to say that we can look back and say we were ever a Christian nation because of the horrific things in our past, but that is to say at least one point in time in our nation, our presidents, our senators, our leaders, our business owners acknowledge that God was who we live our lives under. And as that has eroded and gone away over the years, of course people are left with deep-seated fear. You may or may not be willing to admit it, but human beings are completely inconsistent and completely unreliable. And so if God is removed and out of the equation, then of course you are going to be fearful. And of course you are going to freak out at every little thing. And this fear is at an all-time high right now. I mean, this is the temptation I think we're facing as a nation in so many ways. Let me just talk about two ways this is playing out. And I'm going to get real specific here. And if it offends you, you know, come talk to me. Let's have a great conversation. If we're going to be real as a church and grow as a body, we got to have real conversations. So on one end, there is a deep, real temptation to fear the real virus that's at hand, the pandemic that is upon us, that many of us have been impacted by in real ways. And there is a fear of the virus. And I'm not talking about a healthy concern. I'm not talking about making good preparations. I'm not talking about loving our neighbors well. Those are all good things. I'm just saying some of us, and I'm challenging you to examine your heart and seek the Lord on this, have fallen into a deep fear around the virus. And we've been paralyzed, and we're living paralyzed, and we're not living in freedom. It's an idol of security, an idol of control, an idol of safety. That's the God we functionally worship in that moment. And we maybe bend in and out of it. Okay? The truth is, as we read the scripture, is that we're never promised security in this world. The truth is we are called to live boldly in this world. We're called to live radically in the name of Jesus, love like crazy, and to not live in fear. And if that's you this morning struggling with this, I want to encourage you. Consider your heart. Confess that. Talk about that. That may be a real temptation that you have been dealing with in your life over the last few months. It would make sense. We would have no judgment. I would have no judgment. I've fallen into that myself at times. I had a few freak out moments in the grocery store where I'm just like filled with fear around getting the virus. There's another kind of fear that's at play in our nation. I think we saw it play out tragically at the Capitol over the last several days last week. And it's a fear, not of the virus, not of safety and control. It's actually a fear of losing our rights. It's a fear of being controlled. It's a fear of losing our freedom or our autonomy. And that may be the God that you are functionally worshiping. And that's a real thing in our culture. It's not really talked about, but it's just as much of a fear as the virus. It's a fear of losing our freedom. And sometimes, tragically, Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, are taking this and melding it in some kind of distorted way with Americanism. And it's not healthy and it's not good. Because, here's why, the scripture never promises our freedom in that way. It just doesn't. You will never read the New Testament and hear the Apostle Paul writing to his friends and saying, pray for me to get out of jail. Pray for me to have freedom of speech. Pray for me to have liberty. Pray for me to have, he wants liberty of heart. He's not concerned about liberty in the world. He's never prays. Pray that Caesar would let me out of prison. It's just not a prayer he prays. In fact, he actually continually says the opposite. When I came to Christ, I gave up my rights. When I came to Christ, I laid them down. The gospel calls me in love to lay down my agenda and my rights. I'm not promised anything in this world. When we come into the new life in Christ, our citizenship is hidden with Christ in heaven, and we get to play it out in this world, and we get to not demand things in any direction at all. And that's a hard word, and I get it. And I know it's a really scary and hard time right now in our nation. I get it. I feel it too. I've fallen into this idol as well. I've fallen into that idol of fear. I'm probably a little bit more wired in that direction personally, to be honest. But that's not biblical truth. The enemy will attack us in our vulnerability. And in this moment, he is trying to stir up fear. But there is incredible news for us as a church, wherever you are on that spectrum. Maybe you are just rocking and rolling. You're like, I just love people. I follow the rules. I'm not scared of losing my freedom. I'm fine. Great. If that's you, wonderful. That's not a lot of people right now. And so we need good news from heaven. And this brings us to our last observation here. How then can we resist temptation? You know, you have to examine your heart. You have to talk with your spouse, your friends, your neighbors about where you are on this spectrum. You might be way on one side, way on the other side. Wherever you are this morning, there is good news. Because in this moment of temptation, where the enemy is trying to pick apart Jesus and his relationship with his heavenly Father, he is grounded and rooted through a couple of things. First, the truth of God's word. Every temptation is met with a specific scripture that addresses the particular temptation. And we as believers, we as Christians should follow his example. So let's look at verse 4. Okay? Jesus responds to the question of God's good provision with this. Jesus answered him, "It is written, man should not live by bread alone." In other words, nothing in this world is what truly nurtures you eternally. It's not to say there aren't good things in this world. It's not to say there aren't beautiful things in this world. Absolutely there are. It's just that Jesus looked at the enemy in his eyes and quoted scripture. And he said, listen, the bread of this world is not what feeds me. I am fed by the truth of this book. I am fed by the truth of this book through my heavenly Father. And that's our story. And so anytime that lie, that temptation rises up, that fear rises up in you. May we be a kind of people that says, quoting 1 John, perfect love drives out fear. Lord, I don't want to fall into fear in any direction. I want to live under your perfect security and your perfect love, not fearing anything, not fearing a virus, not fearing losing my freedom. Verse 8, the question of adoration, the question of acceptance, the question of love, the question of being seen. Here's how Jesus answers him. It is written, he's quoting the word of God, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture of Jesus speaking to the lie, the truth. What is he saying? He's saying, I don't need glory. I don't need to be on top of that mountain. I don't need to have authority. He already had authority, by the way, but in our cases, we don't need authority. We don't need to be on top of the mountain. We don't have to be in control. We don't have to get glory because our Heavenly Father is the one who receives glory, and our lives before him are to give him glory. And then in verse 12, where there's a direct attack around the question of security and protection, will God actually protect you? And this is a big one for us right now. Those of us who are struggling with fear of our own security and our own safety, it's a real thing. Jesus replies, Deuteronomy 6:16, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. In other words, you can trust him. He is good. He will provide for you. It's not to say that your life will be easy. It's not to say you won't get the virus. It's not to say you won't lose some freedoms in this world. It's to say that he is good and he is your source and he is your salvation. I love my friend Brett McCracken. He's an editor with the Gospel Coalition, and he has written a work, and he has this great image called the Wisdom Pyramid. I posted it on Facebook. We'll post it on our website this week. And I think it's great because some of us right now, some of our struggle is, where are we getting our information? And are we listening constantly to the lies of the enemy, or are we rooting ourselves in truth? And if you look at this image, we'll put it on the screen here. At the very bottom of the pyramid, it's kind of like a food pyramid, you have the truth of the word. And that's the thing that should inform most of our lives. If you're reading the news more than you're reading the word of God, that's a problem. I'm not saying don't read the news. I'm saying get your source, get your resource, get your nutrients from the Bible. The church, maybe you can't or you don't feel comfortable meeting in person right now. That's okay. Okay, we get that. There's freedom. There's liberty in that to do that. But get on the phone. Get on a Zoom call. Meet with people. Join in with others in a discipleship band. Link in with your community group. Do not allow the enemy to tempt you away from people in this season. Let's get together and be the church together, even if we have to do it through distancing and through technology. I love his pyramid. It goes on. Nature, God's general revelation. It's a way to see God's beauty, for our hearts and our eyes to be lifted to his glory. Books, healthy, good, you know, solid books are great resource that give us truth and help us to shape our mind and our imaginations and thwart off the enemy's attacks. Beauty is a real thing that God created. It's a gift to us, and we want to look at things that are beautiful and enjoy them. And then lastly, at the very top, internet and social media. Just use it for personal stuff. Don't get your news from there. It's not helpful. I know it's hard right now. It's like we don't know where to get our news from. But just if you just follow this idea of letting the word be the basis and going up from there, I think that our lives will be much more free of temptation and free of sin, and we will find ourselves flourishing and thriving as a church and as a community. Secondly, this isn't necessarily in this passage, but the scripture encourages us to confess our sin. That's why we practice confession every week. But here's the opportunity for us, is not just to confess our sin, but can we confess our temptation? Like when you get triggered, when you feel upset, when you start to have that desire to lash out at somebody or to sin in some way, before you act out, can you get a brother or a sister on the phone and just reach out by a text and say, look, I'm really angry right now. I feel like doing something I shouldn't do. I just need to confess that to you. How much better is it to confess your temptation than to confess your sin? And then finally, and this is where the hope and the good news comes for us this morning, because we can do all these things. The temptations will still come, but we need another resource. We need the resource that we talk about each week, the resource of grace, the resource of the cross. We need to look to Christ, not just as an example. He's a great example here. but he's more than an example. We need him as a resource. We need him to saturate our lives. We need to see the cross. We need to see his love for us. We need to see his love poured out and sacrificed for us. And we need to say and be honest about our condition and say, I actually can't resist that temptation on my own, Lord. I need you. I need your grace. And I love what we find in this parallel. In the Old Testament, it was Israel that was testing God, if you remember. But here in this story, it's incredible news. It's God who's allowing himself to be tested. Why would he do that? Why would he do that? Because he's saying something to the world. Because the incarnation of Christ says something to the world. Because the gospel says something to the world. It says, you, O weary world, riveted with fear, burdened, divided, heavy laden, come to me, Christ says, and I will give you rest. What is Jesus doing here? He's showing us that he can do something that Israel could not do and you and I can't do on our own. We're too weak. We're too frail. He's saying, I will carry the temptation for you and I will carry it all the way to the cross. And that's exactly what he did. Because if you remember in the garden, he endured a greater test. His desire, I don't know if we could biblically say tempted, but his desire was to not go to the cross. He was praying to his Father in heaven, Lord, let this cup pass from me. But not what my will is, but what your will is. If we could just have that heart as a church. But Christ endured the ultimate temptation of going to the cross. He went to the cross. He took on the cross. He laid his life down. That when we fall into temptation, when we sin and we will, and when we are riveted with fear and we will be, and when we freak out and worship idols and we will do that, the good news is that we are not condemned. Our relationship is not broken with our Heavenly Father, but it is found whole because Jesus, through the cross, carried our sins, carried all of the ways that we act out, all of our fears upon himself, that we might receive grace and forgiveness and freedom in him. Not necessarily a kind of freedom in this world, but a freedom in him. Christ did what Israel could not do and what we cannot do. This is why Hebrews 4:14-16 encourages us. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. And that's our hope. He is our hope. He is our King. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, and yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And that's what we're in right now. We're in a time of need. We've been in a time of need. We need Jesus. We need his love. We need who he was as a person. We need who he is now interceding for us. We need the power of his resurrection in our lives. Jesus is the new Israel who fulfills God's promise for his people. It's amazing because Israel settled in the promised land after they came through the wilderness. Jesus doesn't settle. He begins to establish a completely new landscape. He begins to establish his kingdom. He begins to form a new humanity, a type of people who are found so secure in their Father's love, that when those temptations come, we're honest about them, we're talking about them, we're working through them, we're struggling, we're stumbling, we're confessing, we're growing, we're being transformed. That's who we're called to be as a church. That's why we're brought together. I was sharing this story about this guy that I was so frustrated with David and Eli the other day, and I was just venting to them. I need to confess that. And I started expressing how frustrated I was and how I just am just totally tempted to relationally go after him or cut him off or just have nothing to do with him. And David, your pastor, our pastor, my brother, he says, Joey, no. Like, what are you talking about, man? like that, what he was part of is not cool. That's not okay. He goes, you're right. And he goes, Joey, he needs the gospel too. He needs grace too. We need grace. You need grace. I need grace. David said, that's the exact kind of person that we talk about, that we need to invite into our gatherings, that we want to bring them in to hear the gospel. Even if we disagree with everything about their life, Christ has accepted you, Joey. Christ has accepted us in him. How can we push people away in that way? How can we be part of the division? How can our fear drive us to be separated from one another? He wasn't saying don't have a conviction. He's saying that even when you disagree, even when there's people who are acting crazy, love, serve, extend grace and mercy, because that's what God in Christ did for you, and that's what we are called to do as a body for them. And the only motivation that allows us to sustain that is the great love that has come from heaven to earth. Let's pray. Father, as we come now to your table, as we've walked through this passage, as we've seen the enemy attacks us in our vulnerabilities, the enemy attacks us at our relationship with you and causes us, wants us to doubt and fear who you are and your provision, Lord, and your glory and your protection. Lord, we're grateful that there is a way that we're able to resist temptation, and it's not on our own strength, but it's through the cross. It's through confession. It's through being honest about our deepest struggles, Lord. I pray, Lord, as we come to this table, we are broken, and we're all in need of your grace at different levels and different ways. Holy Spirit, would you come and unite the church? Lord, would you let us love one another despite even differences that we may hold, different convictions? May we not fall into fear, but may we run to you, Jesus, in this time. And we pray this in your name. Amen. The first Christians were a completely diverse group, Jews and Gentiles, rich and poor. All different sides of the political, economic system. And it was this table that brought them together, remembering what Christ had done for them in love. So Paul writes to the church in Corinth, and if you've ever read the book of 1 Corinthians, you know they were a mess. Probably more of a mess than we are in right now. And that should give us hope. And Paul writes this, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So if you want to pause the video now, grab a piece of bread, a cup, assign somebody in your home to serve. The body of Christ. For you. And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And you can take the cup and go around, and people can dip their bread in it and partake together. We're partaking together as a family here in our homes. This is a defiant act to say before the world, the divided world we live in, we are one in Christ. We worship a King who one day is going to return. And until that day, we are secure. We have life. He's a good father. We sung that earlier. He's with us. He loves us. So let us partake, not just this moment, but let us remember and feast on the gospel every new waking hour of our lives this week. Let's sing this last song together before we close our gathering.
Join me in song. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name, and the land marked is plentiful, for your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when I'm found in the desert place, and the walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name, when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing, and every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. Even when the darkest in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take, you give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. Sing it, y'all. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name.
Can you imagine what it would look like for us as a church moving forward, where we captured that picture of Ephesians chapter 4? As a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you to walk in a manner of all the calling which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit of the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Can you imagine if we were a people who said, you know what? We're not going to live in fear. Some of us tend to be more cautious, more careful. Awesome. Maybe you don't agree with that fully. That's okay. We love you and there's space for you. Maybe you feel a little bit more freedom. You feel a bit more liberty with the virus and things going on. Great. We love you. We accept you. It's what St. Augustine said, to have unity in the essentials, liberty in the non-essentials, and grace, charity, love in all things. That's a picture of who Christ is calling us to be, the church as a whole and us as a church. There is space in this building, in this area, across technology, across our gatherings for you. We love you. We are thankful for you wherever you are in this journey. God's grace reaches you. Let's continue to live in that grace. I want to encourage you, if you consider Downtown Hope your church home, each week we talk about giving, first fruits giving. We give first and then we live on the rest. You can give online. We are thankful for your generosity all through 2020 and into 2021. Let's continue to be generous, not just with our finances, but also with our time and our words and everything. May Christ continue to have us live out of fear, resist the temptation to fear, and to live in Him. Go in peace. Give